Welcome, everyone. It is so great to see everyone today and have the opportunity to worship with you. Let's pray and get our hearts ready for worship. Father, we thank you for this time. I pray that you would bless our time together. Please, Lord, minister to us. Please, Lord, help us to be convicted and challenged, and let us put our convictions into action and see growth and change in our lives today. Speak to us, Lord. Minister to us. Help us to bring glory to you. Help us to give you the highest honor and praise. Help us to worship you. Help us to remember you. And help us to know how much you love us. And help us to love you more than anything in this life. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Now we feel that you are I searched the earth for something that could satisfy, a piece for the hurt I had buried deep inside. Knees on the floor, I finally found everything I needed. You lifted my soul and opened up my eyes.
All right, here are the announcements for today. All right, here are the announcements for today. Our next parking lot service will be January 30th at 10 a.m. That's a Saturday, January 30th, a Saturday at 10 a.m. at our Reynolds building. From now on, until further notice, all of our parking lot services will be the second week, the second Saturday of the month, and the last Saturday of the month. The second Saturday of the month and the last Saturday of the month at 10 a.m. in the Reynolds building moving forward. So please make sure to make a note of that so you can join us every week, or every time we meet. Tomorrow, Sunday, is the last chance to sign up for Bible classes. So if you are interested in signing up, this year we're offering Basics to Christianity for those who are more new to the faith, or those who are more mature but want to go back to the basics. We're also offering Doctrines of Grace in the Old Testament for those who want something a little bit more theological and more in depth. So we encourage you to sign up for either one. And just text me, email me by tomorrow, and I'll make sure to give you more details after that. We also have the young adults every Tuesdays at 8 p.m. On Zoom, so make sure to sign up for that if you're in that age group. And if you have anybody that you know that you would like to have joined that group, many people that are not from our church have joined that group. So if you know anybody that's looking for a group like that, you know, youth, college, young adult, age group, then please make sure to send them to that group. You can ask Matthew Chan or Dennis for more information. Also, I will be sending you a video for a conference about finance, how to, we're starting the year, and this is a conference that is based on biblical guidelines, and they're teaching from a biblical point of view how to manage your finances better. This can help anybody, but it most importantly, it can help our younger people who are just getting started with learning how to manage their finances. And we're probably more in need to know how to better manage our finances than ever before because of the times that we're in. So this will be very helpful. I will send you the video sometime next week, so be looking forward to that, and I hope you watch it and discuss it with other church members and your family as well, and learn from this, and hopefully it gives you help financially. It's led by Dave Ramsey. Dave Ramsey is probably the leading Christian figure today when it comes to coming out of debt, talking about finances from Scripture. Dave Ramsey was somebody that went bankrupt at a young age because of his greed and foolishness, like he says. And that experience led him to study the Scriptures and what God has to say about money. And ever since then, he's been applying those principles to himself, and he's been helping others apply that to themselves. And he's helped many, many people come out of debt and have a much, much stable financial life by teaching them what God says about how to handle money. So it's coming from him, it's coming from his company, is a conference that's going to be very helpful. So I encourage you to participate and invite others to also participate with you. We had announced that we're going to start having midweek prayer meetings in Zoom starting next Wednesday, January 20th. That was supposed to start next Wednesday, January 20th, midweek prayer meetings. However, for the time being, we are not going to do those meetings. We're going to have to cancel because we didn't have anybody sign up for those meetings. So we're not going to have those midweek prayer meetings anymore until next time, until we try again next time. But we are going to implement more prayer times in everything that we do in our church, from Bible classes to services to everything that we possibly can. We're going to pray together more. And even by yourself at home, I know you probably already do, but we encourage you this year in particular to really pray more than ever before, pray harder than ever before, so we can see God move in a powerful way in our families, in our lives, and through our church. All right, that's it for announcements. We will see you in Zoom afterwards for those of you who joined today. See you then. Bye-bye. All right, let's get into the message for today. We continue with Philippians chapter 2, and this is our sixth sermon on Philippians, and it's titled Stop Trying and Start Doing. Stop Trying and Start Doing. We are still in the theme of living out the gospel. We're still in the theme of working out, living in a way that is worthy of the gospel, living the gospel daily in our lives. So far, Paul has given us a lot of examples of what that looks like inside of the church, outside of the church. And today, he continues with that theme that started in chapter 1, verse 27, and it'll end in chapter 2, verse 18, this theme of living out the gospel. And today, he says that living out the gospel, living in a way that is worthy of the gospel, gospel living, living out the gospel daily in our lives, it means to grow spiritually. It means to grow spiritually. So if we're living out the gospel, if we're doing gospel living, then we're growing spiritually daily. That's what Paul wants to talk about today. And we're going to see how we can grow spiritually. We're going to see how we can grow spiritually today from our passage from Philippians. If you have your Bibles, please open with me to Philippians chapter 2, verses 12 through 13. That's Philippians chapter 2, verses 12 through 13. This is what it says in Philippians chapter 2, verses 12 through 13. It says, "Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, so now, not only as in my presence, but much more in my absence, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure." Have you ever been interested in growing spiritually? Has that been something that has always been in the back of your mind? And has that been something that you've always wanted to do, to just continue to grow spiritually? Maybe you felt stuck as a Christian after all these years, like you felt like you were not really growing as much anymore. Well, today Paul explains to us, he shares with us how we can continue to grow spiritually as Christians. And Paul starts by saying that we grow through obedience. Paul here is saying we grow through obedience. The first thing that Paul says is that we grow through obedience. Paul says to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. He tells them to obey him. And then the one thing that they are to obey is to work out their salvation with fear and trembling. The word obey is a strong word that is used here. Paul is saying ultimately obey Christ, but also obey the apostle that has been sent by Christ. He's saying your obedience ultimately is to Christ, but also is to the apostle who Christ sent to the Philippian church. And Paul tells him, this is what you have to obey. This is what you have to obey. You have to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. This is what I want you to do. This is what I want you to obey. Obey is a strong word. It's absolute. It was given to slaves and children back then. They had no choice but to obey. He's saying, obey this as a way of obeying the Lord and obeying the servant that the Lord sent. Obey this. Work out your salvation with fear and trembling. That's what the Apostle Paul is saying. The word work out there, the Apostle Paul is saying, you have, as a Christian, you have to put in effort, energy. You have to do labor. You have to do hard work. You have to really not just be somebody that wishes that they would grow, but somebody that does things, somebody that obeys, somebody that goes from wishing to doing, somebody that does things in their lives, that puts the energy, puts the time, puts the effort, puts the labor to grow spiritually. You have to do your part. Paul is saying, do your part. Do the hard task of obedience. Do work out. You work out your salvation. You do your part in growing your faith spiritually. Don't just sit there. Don't just hope and wish you would grow, but do what is necessary for you to grow. Do your part. Put the energy that is required for you to grow. That's what Paul is saying. That if they want to grow, they need to put themselves to work. They need to work out their salvation. Meaning salvation here, he means that they are still growing, they are still being changed every day into the image of Christ. They are being set free from the presence and the power of sin more and more in their lives. That's what's happening to them. But in order to see that happen, they have to put in the work. They have to put in the effort to really see themselves be more free from sin and become more like Christ. Be sanctified. That's what salvation means in our particular context today. Salvation means to be sanctified. There's three ways to describe sanctification, salvation. One, the first step is justification. This is when we first put our faith in Christ. Justification means immediately we are forgiven for the penalty of sin. Sanctification is the next step. That's the next step in salvation. Sanctification means that, you know, it's a longer process where we're being, what happened to us, the salvation that is being given to us, now it's becoming real in our lives. We're changing according to this salvation. So sanctification is not work to earn salvation. It's work because you already have salvation. Is work out what God has worked in your life. So you're already saved, you're already justified, you have already been saved. So now let it become real in your life. Let it show in your life. It's a long process. And the last stage in salvation is glorification, when we're completely free from sin and the presence and the power of sin. So number one, stage of sanctification is dimension of sanctification is justification, when we're immediately forgiven for the penalty of sin. We're no longer guilty, we're innocent in the eyes of God. Now we're forgiven. And then there's sanctification, longer process where we're becoming what God has already done in our lives, the salvation that He's already given us. And then lastly, glorification, when we live with God for the rest of eternity. So right, but Paul today is talking about the middle stage, the sanctification stage, where we are still growing in our faith. Paul is saying, continue to work out, do your part, put in the time, put in the effort, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. And then here by fear and trembling, he's talking about God. He's talking about God. He's saying that The motivation to work out this salvation daily is fear and trembling. Fear and trembling, these two nouns almost always are used, especially with Paul, are used when they talk about God. So here Paul is saying, work out your salvation with fear and trembling, by fearing God and trembling before God. But this fear, this trembling is actually not a negative fear, not a negative trembling. It's better translated awe and reverence. It's the kind of awe and reverence. It's the kind of fear and trembling you have when you meet your favorite celebrity. When you meet somebody that you admire, that you love, that you've been wanting to meet for so long. Somebody that you love. You just there's so much happiness. There's so much joy. You're so nervous because you want to meet them. It's that kind of fear and trembling. So Paul is saying the best motivator to growth, to spiritual growth, is love of God. This fear and trembling, this love for God will make you put in the necessary work every single day to continue to grow in your faith. So that's, what Paul is saying. The first thing that we need to do, if we're going to be growing spiritually, is you need to put in the work. You need to do the difficult thing, the difficult work, the difficult task. You need to obey. You need to obey and you need to put in the work, and that's how you grow spiritually. Don't expect to grow without putting in the work. Don't expect to grow without putting in the work. That's what Paul is saying. Obedience is hard. Obedience is hard. Obedience is very difficult. It starts at a very young age. My two-year-old son is already disobeying me and my wife. This week alone, or last week, or this week, sometime in the past few weeks, I can remember two instances when he disobeyed because he thought he knew better. At 2 years old, he thinks he's smarter than us, and he thinks he knows what's best for him. So he disobeyed. One time, his disobedience led him to the pet section, where they sell cat food and dog food and stuff for pets at Costco. We don't even have a pet, but he thought he knew what was best for him, and he ended up in the pet section. The second time he disobeyed was a little bit more serious. He almost got hit by a car. He went in a direction we told him not to go to. Even my neighbor saw what was happening, and she started screaming because she thought he was literally going to get hit. It was that close. But the second time, his disobedience almost got him into real, real trouble. But disobedience starts at a young age. Sadly, it doesn't stop as we get older. You know, when we become a little bit younger, and when we're in those stages of our lives, when we're young and passionate and fired up, it becomes even more difficult to obey, to listen, to be told what to do. We don't like to be told what to do. We don't like to listen. We think we know all the answers. We think we're the smartest person in the room, and we might be. But because we can't listen, but because we're not told what to do, instead of being the smartest person in the room, instead of having everybody listen to us, instead of having people follow us, nobody wants to follow us, nobody likes us, nobody wants to hear what we have to say. We're not an asset, even though we're so smart. We become a liability. We're not a strength. We become a weakness. And sooner or later, you know, we keep on losing jobs because we cannot be told what to do because we think we're better than we are. So we hop from job to job, hoping to find a job that will let me, that will finally see all of my gifts and talents and skills and let me really flourish. So we can't keep a job. We go from job to job to job because we can't be told what to do, because we can't listen, because we can't obey. And then, or we're let go by our, boss, because we might be talented, we might have talent and skill, but sadly, that's all we have, and that's not enough to keep somebody who is a troublemaker, in a company or in the workforce or in society. If they're not willing to listen, if they're not willing to be told what to do. If they think they're the smartest person in the room, they usually won't. We usually won't last. That's just it's difficult to obey. Obedience is difficult. It doesn't get any easier as we get older. It actually gets harder. And maybe for those of us who are a little bit older, maybe we're just hopeless. I don't know if we can ever go back to, trying to be obedient. It gets harder as we get older. But Paul today says, for spiritual growth to happen, it is absolutely necessary that we obey. That we obey God, that we obey God first and foremost, but also the authority figures that God has put in our lives, especially for our spiritual well-being. That's what Paul is saying, and it's interesting that Paul actually talks about obedience right after he talks about humility. Remember last week he talked about humility, and today he talks about obedience. Obedience is hard, and it's impossible without humility. There is a reason why Paul talked about humility before he talked about obedience. Only the humble can obey. It's hard to be humble. It's hard to obey. This is why it's very difficult to find people that are humble and find people that are obedient. Almost nobody does it. It's very difficult. But those that actually are humble and those that are actually obedient because they're humble, those are the only ones that will see results in their lives. Those are the only ones that will see good things come into their lives. Those are the only ones that have a future. Those are the only ones that actually get acknowledged for how good they are. Those are the only ones that will actually grow. Those are the only ones that will actually grow. They have the hope of growing. Only those that are humble and because of that obedient can actually grow. Growth doesn't happen to everybody. Just because we're getting older, it doesn't mean that we're growing. We're just getting older. This is why when, people get really old, they become like babies. It doesn't necessarily mean that we're actually getting, growing. We're just getting older if we're not growing. To grow, we need to be intentional. To grow, we need to put the work in. We spiritually, we need to put in the work. We need to do the hard work of obedience. We need to put in the hard work, energy, labor. Growth happens when you are intentional. Not just when you're getting older or just being passive or just being comfortable. Those are the exact same things that keep you from growing. You know, getting older in age doesn't equate to growth. It just means that we're getting older. Growing means we go from wishful thinking, from just hoping to be better, from just hoping to grow, from just wishing to grow, to actually putting in the work to grow. We go from wishing to doing, to actually doing the work to grow. That's the only way we can grow spiritually. We need to put in the work to grow, or there will just be no growth. But the problem with many, many Christians for so long, and even now, the reason why we are not growing spiritually perhaps is because most of us, the only thing that we do is wishful thinking. We just hope that we would grow spiritually. We just wish that we would grow spiritually. But we don't put in the work. It's just wish. I wish I would do this. I wish I would read the Bible more. I wish I would pray more. I wish I would join like Bible studies at church. I wish, you know, I would memorize the Bible. I wish I would do this. I wish I would do that. And then if it's not wishing, we're giving excuses. Ah, but you know what? My church is like this. I don't like my pastor, or I don't like, you know, my church doesn't have a group my age. My church doesn't have this. You know, I don't have a mentor. We come up with either wishing or just giving excuses instead of actually looking at ourselves and being responsible ourselves and doing our own work. Because we're only wishing, we're only giving excuses, and we're not being responsible for our own spiritual growth. That's why we're not growing. That's why we're not growing. And we're only wishing, we're only giving excuses because obedience is hard. This is why we give excuses. This is why we wish, because it's hard. Anything that is hard in life, we have a hard time doing. This is true of every area of life. We only go to wishing, or I wish I would study more, or I wish I would lose weight, or I wish. When it's hard, we only most of the time just do wishing, or we give excuses, or we rationalize why we shouldn't do this and that. But that's exactly how people don't grow. Anybody who's only wishing, giving excuses all the time, because they don't want to do the hard work that is necessary for growth, they're not going to grow. And many times, that's what's happening in the church. We are good at wishing, we are good at giving excuse, but we are not good at doing the hard work. Putting in the work personally, blaming ourselves first, putting in the work personally to make things better spiritually in our lives and in the lives of others. This is why we're not growing. Because we're just wishing, we're just giving excuses, and we're not doing our part. We're not doing the hard work to grow. The best motivator to grow is love. That's what Paul here means by fear and trembling. He's saying the way to stay motivated for you to daily grow, to daily do the hard work of putting in the work and the time and the energy to grow spiritually, the best way that you're going to continue to stay motivated to do that is by loving God. You know, that's what fear and trembling means. Oh, we're so in awe and reverence of God. Oh, he's so amazing. Remember last week we said that we can know that God loves us because of all that he did for us, because of all that Jesus went through, because of the fact that he died for us. We know that he loves us. And usually when we know that we're loved, we want to love back. When we are shown love, we want to love back. So now that we know that God loves us, we can actually love God with fear and trembling. And the best way to do hard work is to love. The reason why parents wake up every morning for their entire lives to work so hard is because they love their children. We want to provide for our children. We want to provide for our family. So we'll work. We only do the work. We only do what's hard if there is love involved. We work hard to feed our children. We work hard in our marriage. You know, a marriage, if you just kind of let it be, it's not going to get better. It's going to get worse over time. This is why people that stay married for 20 years divorce. It's not staying together for a long time that makes a marriage good. It's putting in the work, investing in that marriage. You know, investing in the relationship for 20 years that makes the marriage strong and flourish and good in 20 years. It's not just staying together. It's putting in the work to make the marriage better. Everything only gets better when we put in the work. And we put in the work because we love. Love is the best motivator to put work in, to do hard work. We need to love in order to continue to work, to do what's hard. We love our children, so we work hard to feed them. We love our spouse, so we work hard to work in that relationship so the marriage gets better. This is how we will grow spiritually. We need to understand God's love for us. Jesus dying on the cross for us, and then we need to love God more than anything, and that should lead us daily to work hard in our spiritual life, to not give excuses, to not just be wishful thinking, to not get lazy, but because we love, we'll put in the hard work, and that's what causes spiritual growth. That's, you know, what Paul is saying. You want to grow spiritually? You need to love God more than anything, and that should motivate you and me to do the hard work of obedience, of working out our salvation, of doing the things that we wish we would do, doing the things that we give excuses not to do. We should do those things. We should do those things. It is only when you do those things that you grow. You know, that's what Paul here is talking about. There's no results without putting the work in. There's no results, there's no spiritual growth if you don't put in the work. If you don't do what's hard, if you don't obey, there's no spiritual growth. That's what Paul is saying. And this should make sense to us, right? This is common sense. This should make sense to us. You know, this is common sense. This should make sense to us. You know, not too long ago, when we just started this year, at the beginning of this year, Katie, she texted and messaged a lot of our church members, and she encouraged all of us to join. This app where we can keep each other accountable to exercise more. And many of us joined, and I joined. And because of that, I have been, you know, doing more physical exercise. Every time I'm tempted to stay in my bed, in my warm bed, because it's too cold in the morning, you know, I think of their faces. I remember that they're watching me now. They can see my progress on this app. So I know they're watching me, and I know, you know, like they're exercising with me. They're counting on me. So I get out of my bed. I do the hard thing of getting out of my bed, and I, you know, put a lot of jackets on because it's so cold in the morning. That's the only time I have to exercise. So I go and I exercise. I go hiking or whatever, and then you know, I do the hard work because other believers are watching me. They're counting on me. They're keeping me accountable. And because of Katie, thanks to Katie, I think I'm going to start to see results. I think this year, I'm going to go beyond just wishful thinking, beyond just, oh, I wish I was healthier physically, or I wish I lost weight. I think I'm going to see results because I'm doing the hard work. I'm putting the work in thanks to Katie. So that's how we see results. and physically, spiritually, we need to do the hard work. We need to obey. We need to put the work in. And it's better if we do it together. It's much better if we do it together. So whatever you can join that's together, whether that's the young adults Bible study or the Bible class, whatever you know that you're going to be kept accountable, where you know you cannot slack, where you know that you have to do the hard thing, whatever that is, join that. Join that. So, don't give excuses. Don't just do wishful thinking. Do the hard thing. Do it together with others. And start growing. Start growing spiritually. That's how spiritual growth happens. This is not new to anybody. All of us know this. If we have been Christians for a long time, all of us know that we should do all of these things. We know that. But knowing it and doing it is a different thing. We know it, but we haven't been able to do it on our own power, on our own strength. It's hard. Maybe we tried, but it didn't last more than 2 weeks. It's hard, so we give up. It's hard, so we don't try. It's not that we don't know. We know that we need to do all of these things. We know that we need to obey. We know that we need to do the hard work. But we know that it's easier said than done. We know that we fail every time we try. Well, good news. You can do this because you are not on your own. You are not on your own. Here the passage today says that even though we put in the hard work for growth, here it says that God will be with you, guide you, and lead you, and He will do the spiritual growing for you. He will do the spiritual growing for you. So you are not alone. You can do this because God will give you the strength. You can do this because God will be with you. You can do this because He is the one that will actually cause the growth. You are not alone. You are not alone in this. You just have to do your small part. You just have to get started. Even if you don't understand what to do, where to start, just do whatever you can, wherever you're at. And then here it says, God's going to take over. God's going to take over, and He will do the growing, and He will be in charge of the growing. Yeah, that's what it says, right? Verse 13, it says, "For it is God who works in you, both to will and to work for His good pleasure." It is God who works in you. He gives you both the will, and He gives you the desire to do this. He's working inside of you. He's giving you the desire, and He's doing the work inside of you. He's giving you the desire. He's doing all the growing. So you are not alone. You have God responsible and participating and ultimately fully in charge and in control of your growth. Now, this might be a little bit confusing for some of us, because I just said that we are responsible for our growth, and now I'm saying God is responsible for our growth. So maybe a little bit confusing, but it really is not. This means it's not either or. It's not, oh, am I doing the growing? Is God doing the growing? It's not either or. It's both and. It means ultimately God is in control. Ultimately God does the growing. But He uses my efforts. He lets me participate in this growth. Ultimately, God is in charge. Ultimately, God is sovereign. Ultimately, God does the growing. But somehow, some way, He uses my small efforts for this growth. And he does this gladly. He does this gladly. Nothing brings God more joy than our spiritual growth. Nothing brings God more joy than to see us grow spiritually. Did you think you as a parent, it brought you joy to see your children grow spiritually? Well, to God more so. Nothing brings Him more joy than to see you and me grow spiritually. He does this with gladness. It's kind of like, for my children, I don't grow them. You know, I don't grow them. Actually, let me use my example. For myself, I have no control of my own growth. If I did, I would not be the height that I am now. I would be somewhere around 6'5", 6'6". I don't have the power to grow myself. But I do have to eat. I do have to contribute. I don't have the power. I don't have control of my growth. But I do have to contribute by eating. And somehow all I do is just put food in my mouth. And then God does the growing. Somehow, some way. With my children too. I can't grow them. But I have to feed them. I don't even know how growth happens. I don't see it happening on a daily basis, but it's happening. And then I notice it after a few months. That's how it works. We do our small part. It still counts. But ultimately, God is in full control of the growth. So we don't have to really worry about too much. It's the best of both worlds. Because God is in control, we don't have to feel the pressure, you know, of being responsible. But because also we play a role, we don't have to get lazy. We can't get lazy. We still need to do our part. So it's the best of both worlds for God to be in control and for us also to have to do our part. Because we don't have the pressure of being responsible, but also we can't get lazy and we have to do our part to grow. It's just the best of both worlds. You know, it's kind of like, you know, when people say, why should we pray if God, you know, he knows everything? John MacArthur says, you know, Paul believed in the limitless sovereignty of God. He also knew that God's sovereign plan incorporates the prayers of his people. So yes, God is in control, God is sovereign, but God uses the prayers of his people. That's how God works everywhere in the scriptures. Why should we evangelize if God already knows who's going to get saved? God will use you to tell those that are saved that they're saved. It's always like that. It's a partnership, it's a combination of God and us. Somehow in his sovereign grace, he lets us participate in this growth. Even though he's in charge, even though he's in control, and even though ultimately he does the growing, he lets us participate. So we don't get lazy. So what we do has consequences or rewards, but ultimately we don't have the pressure to be responsible because God is fully responsible. The best of both worlds, where there's no pressure and we can't get lazy. So, if you feel a little bit lost, if you feel like, you know, you don't know where to start, if you feel a little bit discouraged, if you feel overwhelmed, you don't have to be. God will come by your side. He will grow you. He will do the heavy lifting. He will do the things that you and I cannot do. We're not on our own. We have a coach, a heavenly coach, a heavenly father who will make our spiritual life flourish. You know, it's kind of like, I guess, if you're an athlete and you make it to the Lakers, you know, for example, Lakers, you're going to flourish. The Lakers will back you up. They will make sure to make you grow so much more than what you could on your own as a player. It's kind of like, this is why spiritual growth should be exciting. This is why we should have anticipation and expectation. Because it's not just a trainer that we have. It's not just the Lakers that we have on our side. It is God who is doing the growing. We should expect a lot more. We should anticipate a lot more. This spiritual journey should be so much more rewarding and exciting and amazing than we could ever imagine, because God can do so much more than we can on our own. We're not on our own. God is doing the growing. We have him on our side. So we should expect, anticipate so much more. Not be discouraged. Not be overwhelmed. Not become hopeless. You know, that's what Paul is saying. You do your part, you do your small part, but make sure you still do that part. You do your small part, you let God take care of the rest. You see what it does with your spiritual life. You see, you know, what the spiritual journey that he takes you in that you never thought or imagined could exist. That's how we grow spiritually. We do the hard work out our own salvation, and then we let God do the rest. We're not alone. We are not alone. God is in charge. God does the growing. We don't have to be overwhelmed. You know, that's what this passage says. You know, here it says that God finds gladness in our spiritual growth. Like nothing brings God more joy than seeing us grow spiritually. That's what he says, right? That's what he says in verse 13. He says, "For it is God who works in you, both to will and to work, for his good pleasure." It brings God pleasure to see you and me grow spiritually. Why wouldn't it bring him pleasure? It's something like this. You know, you and I were created in the image of God. Then sin entered the universe, and that image of God became disfigured. Sin made us into something totally different. It deformed, you know, the beauty that God had created. We became sick. And to grow spiritually, to be sanctified, means that we start to get restored. It means that we get disentangled from sin and we start to recover the beautiful image of God that he originally created us with more and more every single day. It means we're becoming healthier. It means we're becoming less sinful. We're sinning less. It means that we're becoming more and more godly. It means that we're becoming more and more like the image of God. It means that sin is losing its power and control in our lives. It means that we're getting healthier. It means that we're getting restored. It means that we're becoming beautiful again. That's why God is glad. What kind of parent would not be glad to see their sick child come back to health? That's what's happening when we're growing spiritually, and that's why God is glad. God is a good father. That when he sees us come back into being the sons and daughters of God that he created us to be, he finds joy. It's so joyful to see us come back to health, spiritual health, day by day. This is why it's a pleasure to God. Our spiritual growth brings gladness to God. It's not only gladness to God, but this is how you and I find joy. This is how you and I find joy. What else can be more joyful than to be sick and to start to get healthy? Have you been really, really sick before? Have you been maybe in such a bad, tragic, you know, accident or sickness, you know, that it took you a long time to recover from? Is there anything better than to start to regain vitality? Is there anything better than, you know, more joyful than start to regain health? Is there anything more joyful than start to get stronger and healthier and be your old self again? Is there anything more joyful than that? And not only that, is there, you know, we find joy when we're growing. If we are not growing, we are already dead. We just don't know it yet. The comfortable life, the convenient life, these are things that steal our joy. The life of joy is one where we're constantly growing. Joy comes from growth. If you're growing, if you're improving, you know, if you're learning, if you're gaining, if you're growing, that's a life of joy. Joy comes to somebody who still has life in them and they're growing. Joy comes from growth. So every time we give an excuse, every time we just do wishful thinking, we're killing ourselves. We're taking joy away from ourselves. That's the very thing that kills joy. Joy is found in growth. You know, last year was very tough. This year, doesn't seem to have gotten any better yet. We're still going through a difficult season that started last year. But January is a good month for a new beginning. It's a good month for a fresh start. It's a good month for us who are in bad shape, out of shape in so many ways because of such a difficult year that we had. We're just lost, we're confused, we're scattered, we're depressed, we're physically unhealthy, we're spiritually unhealthy. This is a good month to get back in shape spiritually. This is a good month to get back in shape spiritually. This is a good month, if you're not a Christian, this is a good month for you to meet God. This is a good month for you to experience all of these spiritual blessings. This is a good month for you to be spiritual, knowing God, rather than being spiritual with no God. Just trying to be spiritual, but not really having a relationship with God. You really want to be spiritual? You really want to experience spirituality? Then you need to know the source of that. You need to know God. Then you can really experience the power that He gives to change your life, to give you the energy and the strength and the salvation that He only can give. This is a perfect time for you to start a new spiritual journey by giving your life to Jesus. All you got to do is invite Jesus into your life. Just tell Him, I give you my life. Please, let me start this new year with you. If you've been a Christian for a long time, is the perfect time for you to get in shape spiritually, to make that commitment, to make sure that you do the hard work, to make sure that you join things that can help you do that. This is a good time for you to get an optimal spiritual shape. I invite you to do that. I encourage you to do that. Stop being too busy for God. Stop giving excuses. You know, stop just doing wishful thinking. But instead, do the hard work. Instead, work out your salvation with fear and trembling this month. And see God gladly do wonderful things spiritually in your life in 2021. Let's pray. Father, we just pray. It's been a tough year. It's difficult to just even like live day by day these days for so many. I pray, Lord, that You would help us to get back in shape in the most important area of our lives. If we're out of sync spiritually, everything in life will be out of sync. We need to get back in sync with You. We need to get back into good spiritual shape. Please help us to do that. And in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
All that I am, all that I have, I lay them down before You, Lord. All my regrets, all my them Yours. Lord, I offer my life to You, everything I can do. Use it for Your glory. Lord, I offer my days to You, lifting my praise to You as a pleasing sacrifice. Lord, I offer You my life. Things in the past, things yet unseen, wishes and dreams that are yet to come true. All of my hope, all of my plans, my heart and my hand are lifted to You. Lord, I offer my life to You, everything I can do.
heaven for your glory. Lord, I offer my days to you, lifting my praise to you as a pleasing sacrifice. Lord, I offer you my life. Lord, I offer you my life.
All right, let's do the benediction for today. GBC, may the Lord bless you and keep you. GBC, may the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. GBC, may the Lord look with favor on you and give you peace. Amen.